Everyone, remain calm.
Yeah. Ooh, that's how it always starts. And later there's running and screaming.
Somebody talk to me! What is happening?
Welcome to Jurassic World.
You're listening to the Jurassic Park Podcast.
You want to consult here or in my bungalow?
Hold on to your butts.
Well, we're back.
Hello and welcome to the 91st episode of the Jurassic Park Podcast. I'm your host, Brad Jost, and we're here to discuss all things Jurassic Park. We're back this week with another full episode of news and images from the sequel film production, a great chat in the Visitor Center with two daily Jurassic Park podcasters, Kyle and Brady from Jurassic Park Minute, and we'll wrap it up with a new audio segment this week from Chris Pratt called What's My Snack? So, this past weekend, we gave away a ton of tickets to Jurassic World the Exhibition, so congratulations to everybody who won. We can't wait to hear your trip reports. Now, if you didn't win, of course you know, we have a special promo code available to listeners of the podcast to use for Jurassic World the Exhibition. Head to fi.edu or call the museum at 215-448-1200 to purchase tickets and use the code JWGENER to get $5 off daytime adult admission tickets to Jurassic World the Exhibition. Now, this is limit to 4 tickets per person. It does include general admission to the Franklin Institute, but it cannot be combined with any other offer or discount. Upgrades are available on site for the IMAX and 3D theaters. It is redeemable online, over the phone, or at the ticketing desk. Processing fees do apply when ordering your tickets in advance. It does exclude holidays, but it is valid through April 19th, 2017. Again, the promo code is JWGENER. Use it and let us know when you do. It's a long episode this week, so why don't we get things started off with a bit of Jurassic news from around the world.
18 minutes and your company catches up on 10 years of research.
Access rate program. Access new security.
These pictures were taken in hospital in Costa Rica 48 hours ago.
I don't want to jump to any conclusions, but look.
Boy, my head being right all the time.
But today, I gotta see it.
First up here, we want to wish a congratulations to director of the upcoming Jurassic World sequel, JA Bayona, on another big win for his film A Monster Calls. Empire Magazine held the 2017 Empire Awards, and the winner of Best Sci-Fi Fantasy Film goes to A Monster Calls, so that is a big win for director JA Bayona. It's a great film, and there's such a big buzz around this film, so congratulations to him and everybody involved in that project on this awesome win. Head to our show notes where you can find all the winners from the Empire Awards for 2017. I know this is a news segment, but I guess maybe we need to start actually a new Jurassic World 2 photo segment or video segment here, because so many pictures have been rolling in recently, and it seems like Bryce Dallas Howard has taken the charge and posts basically a daily photo of her progress here on the sequel film. And she started off day 11 by saying,
"My, but that's some tall scaffolding. Whatever is on that stage must be giant."
And yeah, it's just a picture of scaffolding. Somebody's walking across it. There's some lighting there. But yeah, that's about it. Nothing really hinting at what's to come in the sequel. She also followed it up on day 12 with a lovely letter from her co-star Justice Smith. That's awesome. And she kicked it off again day 13 with a lovely picture of her sitting in the makeup chair getting ready for the film. And things started to get a little bit better here, not just from her, but from everybody else in the project. Day 14, we see a harness of some sort here, something that could be held to hold her up, maybe in a dinosaur's teeth. Is she getting eaten? I don't know. We'll see. But is she getting picked up by a pteranodon? I don't know. It could be something like that, or maybe she's just jumping off a big cliff. I don't know. It could be incredibly terrifying here, whatever's to come. But day 14, she started off with that picture saying, "Hold on to your butts." But like I said, that's just where it started to get interesting, because J.A. Bayona himself on Twitter and I guess Instagram and other places, he posted a video of, it looks like a forest background with foggy, you know, clouds in the back. And there's this hand puppet T-Rex that he's doing this little roaring pose and screaming and roaring and everything. And that's about it. It's only like 6 seconds long, but I think it's actually a little telling. On the edges, you can sort of see a stand holding up a backdrop. So I don't think this is a real image, a real background of trees. Maybe somebody took that picture or shot a video or something like that, but that's not real. So we're to assume, based off the location of the image and the video, that it's just at Pinewood Studios. So I don't know what this is. It could be something we see in the film. Maybe not. Who knows at this point? But Colin Trevorrow followed that up with a picture of himself filming that scene with Bayona in the shot with the hand puppet. It's really awesome. And I love seeing that he is involved with this almost, I guess, on a daily basis here. And that's going to be a lot for him, because he will have Star Wars coming up. So it is great to see him still involved in that sense. And to see all these people contributing to our daily progress with the film, letting everybody know in the fan base like what's going on, what's happening behind the scenes. So it's really cool to see that. But we do get another thing here from Bayona. It's a picture of
11 puppeteers working under the feet, giving life to a dinosaur. Great work.
This is an awesome one. I absolutely love this picture, because it's reminiscent of an older time with all the other films, with when you had all these puppeteers working on the different dinosaurs throughout the film. Obviously, Jurassic World had one, but this looks like it could be something even better, even bigger. Who knows? Because they're working underneath this creature. So how big is this thing? I really hope it's big. I'm expecting something really awesome. But if you want to check out these pictures, head to our show notes. We'll have all the pictures from Bryce and Colin and Bayona here, and certainly some more. So check that out. Now, last week, I didn't want to burden you all too much with my terrible voice since I wasn't feeling too well, but this week, I do want to cover a few Jurassic birthdays that we missed from the past week. The 13th was William H. Macy's birthday, Paul Kirby from Jurassic Park 3. Happy birthday to you, sir. On the 15th of March, we missed wishing a happy birthday to Brian T. Hamada from Jurassic World. Now, he didn't really get too much screen time because he was taken out pretty early on by the Indominus. Happy birthday to you. And this week, on the 22nd of March, let's wish a happy birthday to Nick Robinson, Zach from Jurassic World. It's been great having you here in the franchise. Who knows what the future holds for your character, but for now, let's all wish you a happy birthday.
Oh, there it is. There it is.
The closest you will ever come to living dinosaurs. Jurassic World, the exhibition. Now in its final weeks at the Franklin Institute, based on one of the biggest blockbusters in cinema history. Don't miss this awe-inspiring event for the whole family. Only at the Franklin Institute. For tickets, visit fi.edu. And remember, if something chases you, run!
Let's open up the doors to the Visitor Center, where I speak with Kyle and Brady from Jurassic Park Minute about their Movies by Minute podcast, the Jurassic Park franchise, and more. This week in the Visitor Center, I'm joined by two fellow podcasters, Jurassic Park podcasters, for a little while longer, Kyle and Brady from Jurassic Park Minute. How you guys doing?
Hey, doing great, man. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, Brad, thanks for having us. We're really big fans of the show, and we're happy to be on.
No, you know, me too. I'm a huge fan of your guys' show and everything, and I hope more people listen to it. And you are at the end, but I don't think that matters at this point. Anybody can listen to podcasts whenever. So it's, you know, why not now, towards the end of your show? Let's get you on and talk about it. But before we get into it, I'm going to start you off, both of you guys off, with a question I ask everybody who comes on here. If you get stuck in a kitchen, which you guys might know something about since I think that you're around that minute as we speak, with a Velociraptor, what will you do and will you make it out alive?
I'm going to try to find some refrigerated flan and slide it across the floor and then hope to God that I don't Scooby-Doo my way out of there and just my feet spin while I'm trying to run. But I'm going to say I wouldn't make it out. I don't know how Brady feels about that.
I tell you what, I would just stand up. I'd throw my hands up, walk to the refrigerator that Tim finds himself in, the freezer, find whatever ice cream Hammond hadn't been eating, and just start eating my last supper. You know, a tub of ice cream, and just let that thing come and do what it's got to do.
You would choose just to give up then, which would be great. Because, I mean, up until that point in time, how many people would have even been eaten by velociraptors? Like, if you're going to go, be an original, you know, and go in a way that nobody else has before.
Seriously. You know, recently on the show, we had JC of Jurassic Collectibles on, and we were covering the minute where Muldoon is eaten. And he had a really good observation in the sense that when Muldoon, his last sentiments are "clever girl" to the raptor. He's sort of saying, like, good job, you know, do what you got to do. Now I kind of tip my hat to you for being able to take me down this way.
Yeah, so you got me. That's it. I'm done. Yeah. You know, I might as well congratulate you, you know?
Yeah, like if there's any way that this guy, this professional who had such a interest in raptors was going to go, this might be the way that he wanted to go. Who knows?
Yeah, it is interesting. I've asked this question to a lot of people and, you know, half the people would give up and die or not make it out. Some people come up with some really cool, interesting ideas. And then, you know, it's tough because it just goes both ways. You never know where you could go. But like you are, I forget who was. Who was that? Somebody did say, like, it would be an honor to, like, go out that way, the same way, you know, like, to be one of those people because not many people have gotten eaten by a raptor.
Well, what would you do?
If I haven't achieved anything in life, I will achieve something in death, being the first person to go this way. So let's have it. Yeah.
What would you do, Brad?
You know, I always have a tough time answering this question, but I've heard so many options, so I should have a legit answer by now. But, you know, I think I'm just going to go straight at it. You know, like, I'm going to grab pots and pans, do anything, just go straight at it. Because I feel like, you know, when you do that, when you try to intimidate, you always hear about, like, you know, intimidating an animal. Like, if you get caught, you know, in the woods near a bear or something, you hear different, you know, versions of what you should do. But you always hear that one where you just kind of stand your ground, you know? So, I don't know. I might do something like that. But velociraptors are unpredictable. And I don't know if it really works out that way.
No, and I wouldn't want to find out. I would just want to run for the ice cream and do, you know.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Go out doing something you like, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
He died as he lived, eating Cherry Garcia.
That's right.
You guys make a good point, though, the other day in your podcast, that there was all that food and goodies and stuff outside of the door, and the raptors just kind of, like, went right by it and didn't even eat them that we know.
Yeah.
You know, didn't, like, divulge in some great, you know, Jell-O or something.
Right.
I think the kids probably could have bought an extra minute or two. You know what? Or maybe that's where the other raptor was. I didn't think about this until you just said that. You know, the one raptor smells blood. She's the dominant alpha. She goes in there to look for him, and she has to say, hey, wait a minute. Why don't you come here? There's actual fresh, bloody meat in here. And what would have been great is if that other raptor came in with, like, half a pie hanging out of its mouth. You know, something like that.
Or if she said, like, you know, hey, more for me. So start calling to the other raptor and say, you know what? There's a cheesecake in there. Why don't you just go settle for that? And I'll keep looking for these other human beings in here. Nope. No. Didn't happen that way. Instead, we got an exciting scene where they're both hunting people, you know?
Yeah.
So,
yeah, I don't know. The tension would have been a little bit different if it had something hanging out of its mouth or, you know, something like that. But, you know, maybe when they run out of the room, they could have, like, you know, shown that the food was definitely dug into or messed around or on the ground or something. That would have been interesting.
Yeah.
Man.
You know what you could do? I guess we're just going to keep this going here.
Might as well. Apparently.
Yeah. Okay, so we're in a kitchen. There's going to be food around. What if there was, like, a just big thing of bananas and you could just start taking the banana peels and throwing them, like, in the path of the raptor, and so he just starts, like, sliding, and next thing you know, problem solved.
So this thing just turns into a Three Stooges sketch at that point. Yeah,
Benny Hill theme starts playing, you know.
You know, it's not that far off, you know, because the raptor goes into the freezer and starts sliding all over the place. So essentially just a bunch of bananas. Like,
yeah. Dude. Yeah. And okay, so like that raptor, it's presumed, you know, died in the freezer. It's still in there, basically.
Yeah.
They should have gone in there in Jurassic World, opened the thing up, and there's that dead raptor just completely bloated, like 20-some-odd years later.
Yeah.
You know?
It's just been eating all that ice cream in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or here's the other side. It could be a Demolition Man type scenario where the thing is frozen, and then it unthaws itself, and it's like, wait a minute, I'm still chasing those kids.
Dude.
You know, it's like cryogenically frozen in there. I think we just cracked the plot on Jurassic World 2.
I think you did.
That is, though, an interesting discussion because, like, you see the kids walk through there in Jurassic World, which seemingly looks untouched, right? So yeah. mm-hmm. they've built an entire theme park around this building. Why have they not touched it? And is that raptor still in there? I don't know. I mean, that is actually like, you know, you can poke fun at it and make light. But actually, when you think about it, like, why is that place untouched? That's so weird.
That's a really great question. I'm going to take the my serious answer to it is that it's probably because the script called for it to be in a new area of the island. However, we discussed on the show several times, the thing that we're more interested in is really revisiting that old part of the island and seeing what it's like, you know, what has nature done with it. You think a company like InGen would really want to reclaim assets, you know, like yeah. after the events of the Lost World, and they're really trying to recoup some of their losses on this whole thing, that they would want to go back and, you know, try to reuse this stuff. Because I wish there was a little bit of, and maybe there is some supplemental material about this, but the passage of time between Jurassic Park or the Lost World and Jurassic World, like what exactly their financial situation was, you know, did they just want to like chalk it up to a loss and not go back to that part of the island? But it seems like there's so much real estate up there. There's so much that could be collected. The first thing that they would do is have a team go back in there and try to like scrap what they could from all this stuff, you know,
right.
going yeah. in and like even pulling copper out of the walls and stuff like that. You know, I've been around enough contractors to know that if you can go back and reclaim that stuff, it could be used. But, you know, it that was one of my favorite parts of Jurassic World, was whenever they went back to that. And I thought the rest of the movie was actually going to be in the other part of the island. I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. We could see what happens up there. And unfortunately, well, that didn't happen. And we, you know, got the movie we got. But I guess what I'm trying to say there is there's a lot of fertile ground there for them to go back and maybe mm-hmm. check it out in Jurassic
yeah,
World too.
But. You know, I really thought that Mark Englert's poster that Colin Trevorrow released, I think it was at Comic-Con, you know, about yeah. like a yeah. year or so mm-hmm. before the movie, that had the raptor perched on top of the tour vehicle that was turned over. Kind of, I knew that we were going to be revisiting old property in the movie, but that mm-hmm. kind of led me to believe that there was going to be more stuff than just the visitor center that I had heard about. So I really got my hopes up. Now, I know that's kind of fan service, and that's just the nostalgic in me wanting to see the familiar thing. So I am really happy that we got what we got, but I definitely would have loved to have seen more. And yeah. that definitely was where my interest peaked in Jurassic World, was at that moment. Mm-hmm. I'd love for them to go back, you know, in Jurassic World 2. The likelihood of that, I guess, is slim, but, you know. Yeah, yeah, I guess that's the end of my statement on that.
You know, you guys break down the first movie so much, and you realize why people love it so much. And I think that's part of the problem when it comes to Jurassic World for some, is that they take that first movie and they've had it for 20 plus years at that point, and you know, they expect things. And when you see that poster that with the raptor on the explorer, you kind of expect that, and then you expect something else. You have this headcanon and all these other theories out there of what you're going to see. And then they only spend, you know, 3 minutes max probably at the visitor center, the old visitor center. And you're, mm-hmm. you are kind of disappointed. And then if you guys were to like, just, you know, do like a Patreon episode of that moment and just kind of compare, that would be actually really interesting, because there are so many differences to like the outside of that building versus how it looked in the first movie, you know, and the inside looks really good, but it's that like outside that's just not done exactly right. It looks cool, but it's not the same. You can tell it's not the same. But it's yeah. stuff like that's fun to kind of pick apart and notice when you do, I guess, you know, your kind of format here.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, and the format has really opened up. Can you hear me? I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, the format of digesting the movie minute by minute has really made me appreciate it more on a filmmaking level that maybe I didn't beforehand. Jurassic Park is one of those movies where it's so visceral in a lot of ways. You get in there and you get caught up in the adventure and the excitement of it that sometimes you almost forget you're watching a movie. It takes on that kind of like amorphous, magical level that filmmaking as a viewer sometimes has. And you know, Steven Spielberg, most of his movies are like this. He can get you get caught up in the joy of cinema. So it's really been cool to take Jurassic Park and break it down and look at it on a script level, you know, look at it on a level of the bare basic filmmaking aspects of this movie that, and you really start to realize this is why this movie is so important to so many people. It works on so many different levels. There's such care taken to the cinematography of it, to the characters, the way that they're built, that it really kind of you start to kind of peek behind the curtain a little bit, and that magic is realized to you in a way that is digestible. So it's been a really great exercise to break down Jurassic Park and really pick it apart like this. It really is. It's been a real rewarding experience.
Yeah, you know, it is interesting because I do this on a weekly basis. I don't do it every day like you guys do, but you know, we break down a lot of different things throughout the entire series, and you certainly got to know a lot about it. But when I did your show for the two episodes, I believe, right, you really have to like dive deep and like find different, you know, knowledge that you can really give forth through the episode to spread it out and to make the episode last longer, to really inform the listeners as to what exactly is happening. And it's a completely different craft, and I am pretty new to this whole minute by minute podcast format. So I guess if people don't know, you kind of just go minute by minute literally and just, you know, peel apart each minute of that film, and you guys do it on a, you know, what, 5 days a week. So that's really impressive.
Yeah, it's, well, go ahead, Kyle, go ahead.
No, I was actually going to cue you. I was going to say, like, Brady is the kind of the guy that got me into Movies by Minute podcasting as well, and I think he's kind of a historian on how this form has come forward, right, Brady?
Yeah, I actually became familiar with Movies by Minutes through a podcast called James Bonding, where some guys from the Nerdist will, you know, cover different James Bond movies, and they mentioned Star Wars Minute and the premise of it, and so I kind of got hooked on that, and I remember thinking, like, there are so many movies that are just primed for this, for this format. And what could those be? And then I looked into it, and just, I mean, more and more just started popping up and popping up and popping up. And I said, there's two movies that just have to be broken down like this. And there's just something inside of me that's calling me and telling me I need to do this. And those movies are Ghostbusters and Jurassic Park. So somehow no one had jumped on those properties. And there were other more like kind of obscure left of center movies that people were doing. So we started Ghostbusters, and I went ahead and bought JurassicParkMinute.com and then went right into that. And it's, you know, it's a lot of work turning these things in 5 days a week, and it's coming up on a year that every day we've been doing this, but incredibly rewarding, not just as a movie fanatic, but fanatics of these two properties, these two films, Ghostbusters and Jurassic Park. And Ghostbusters was amazing because there is so much to learn there and so many more new things to pick up by breaking it down. But I've actually had a more rewarding experience with Jurassic Park. And I think it's because this movie is a little bit closer to my heart. And there are so many different things just underneath the surface that are there for you to pick up on, but only if you want to go in and look for them and analyze them. This movie doesn't demand that you understand so many different things. It presents you with things and then gives you an adventure. And that's it. And that's all it should be. You know, it's an incredibly intellectual adventure film, but it never forces anything down, any of these topics, any of these ideas down your throat. It's just enough there for you to pick up on and go and explore yourself if you want, or break it down minute by minute, 5 days a week. So, you know, it's, yeah, but I guess this is the longer answer. The Movies by Minutes format is, it's an amazing, amazing thing. I've actually moved into Goonies Minute with another guy. And so we've been breaking that movie down, and there's a lot going on in that movie to break down, but definitely not as much as Jurassic Park. So
yeah, you know, the format, it kind of makes it more digestible, I think, you know, because I'll release an episode that's an hour plus, sometimes less, but you guys are releasing smaller bits of episodes, and I think that makes it easier for people to listen and to latch on and to listen every day, essentially. Like, I think that makes it much easier, and it's really cool to have that ready, waiting for you, you know, when you wake up and you know it's on your phone. That's kind of cool. I like that.
Yeah, and you know, another thing about that too is I love whenever some of the Movies by Minutes shows that I like, you know, you wake up in the morning and it's in your queue and it's like a 45-minute long episode, so you know there's going to be all kinds of information there for you. And so what's cool about even releasing something that's about 15 to 20 minutes long is it's going to give somebody else the idea that they can go do this themselves. They can go break this movie down themselves and develop their own interpretation of it, take what they're hearing from us, and then go find new things for themselves. So in that regard, it's kind of inspiring to people who are fans of the movies, but want to see it even deeper and go into it even further. So yeah, it's a cool format, and I'm really glad that the guys who did start it and get the ball rolling with the format did what they did, because it's given so much entertainment to people and so many opportunities for fans of these films and these franchises to explore them even more for themselves and for listeners of the shows.
Yeah, so. They've been kind of like open sourced and very good shepherds of the format as well. Brady, when he originally had the idea for Ghostbusters Minute, first thing we had to do was kind of send them an email and say, would you guys mind if we took your format and applied it to this? And their thing is like, they were kind of like, hey, yeah, that sounds really cool. That'd be a good movie. Why don't you go for it? And they have really fostered a community of these movie by minute podcasters out there that they've been, you know, partially like hands off you know, with, just kind of letting people take their product and or show and like run with it. Mm-hmm. But it's been a very supportive community out there. We all kind of chat with each other about, oh, what do you do if you run into this, or how do I work on this for my movie, or what kind of recording equipment do you want to use? So it's the movies by minute community is one that is just going to continue to grow. There's really been kind of an explosion in the last 6 months of the number of movies that people are breaking down in this podcast format. And Brady and I are privy to a couple of shows that haven't been announced yet, and there's really going to be no slowing down for this format within the next like probably year or two.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
I can't imagine it will slow down, you know, because it is so digestible. And when I, you know, go to search for one of these types of podcasts, there's everything that I'd want to listen to. Like, and it's funny, you keep stumbling upon them. And, you know, like, I believe there's Indiana Jones, Back to the Future. I just saw Pirates of the Caribbean. Like, that's certainly something I would love to listen to. All those.
It's a great show, too. Yeah. All those shows you just named are top tier podcasts. If you any interest out there, I would definitely say check on those, because they're awesome.
We actually have our Patreon subscription account. You can go to patreon.com/PeleMedia and hear some, like, bonus episodes, bonus content that we release. Most of them are Jurassic Park related, but recently my co-host Chris over at Goonies Minute and I did a special with one of the hosts of Pirates of the Caribbean Minute, and we broke down our top three pirate films. It was a lot of fun. So the hosts over there at Pirates of the Caribbean are doing a hell of a job. And that's another movie that's just so prime to be broken down minute by minute.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But, you know, it's like Kyle saying, the one thing that I think I'll take away from all this experience is the relationships that I've made from meeting other people in that community and meeting other people in the Jurassic Park online community. Like your show, for example, is something I've wanted to be on since I've been listening to it long before I ever got the idea to do a Movies by Minute show. Huh. And so it was something I would listen to, and I'd hear the other people on and be like, damn, I just want to go geek out with my people, you know? And so to be able to finally be on it, which is today, you know, we had you on our show, but this is the first time I'm actually being able to do that. And you know, getting to develop a relationship with you has been awesome. And then Jennifer Tarek, who's a frequent guest of your show, mm-hmm. And so many other people, has just been the thing that I'll take away from Jurassic Park Minute the most.
So this whole thing has been a ploy just to get on the Jurassic Park
much.
Podcast.
Pretty saying? Much.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Well, it worked.
Yeah. It worked.
It's kind of cool, too, because we actually had a couple of guys that were listening to our show. And, you know, we had no plans of doing The Lost World as our next show. But a couple of guys said, hey, you know, are you going to do this? We're like, no, it's open. And they took it, and they've actually started The Lost World Minute, too. So
yeah.
That show's actually – it has a little bit of a different distribution format, but their names are Brad and David over there. So they started Lost World Minute a couple of weeks ago, and I think that they it's not a weekly show. They put it out, like, every couple of weeks or something like that. But so if people have liked what they've heard on Jurassic Park Minute and wanted to move over to The Lost World, that show is actually going on right now.
Yeah. And, you know, I think it's going to be great when someone else or them or whoever picks up Jurassic Park 3 and then, of course, Jurassic World. I'm sure it's only a matter of time until someone moves in on that as well.
Or hell, even redoes Jurassic Park. We've always said that, you know, our voices shouldn't be the last or the authoritative way to listen or to this movie in a minute-by-minute podcast. I would love it if in a couple of years somebody decided to just go back to Jurassic Park and do it again. It'd be a lot of fun to listen to.
Yeah, as fans of these films, you got to support the idea that there should be a multitude of perspectives on these things. And I know that I would love to hear that. For sure. Is someone else shed light on it for me and give me their perspective on it. So
yeah. And you guys, you brought up Jurassic Park 3 and Jurassic World, and those two films are pretty polarizing for a lot of people. Now, do you mm-hmm. think, has there been any kind of minute-by-minute podcast that once you dive in, do you feel or have you heard people like kind of like start to dislike the movie or anything like that? Because it seems like a passion project where you love the movie and you really get to know it even more. Do you find ever that you're like, I don't know, I see the flaws now?
That's a really good question. I don't know that that's happened. I think a lot of the people who jump into these movies are kind of experts on it to begin with, and part of it is the vanity of trying to show off like what you know about the movie and, you know, the filmmakers and the filmmaking world and everything. But I think that if anything, this movie has made me love, or this project has made me love Jurassic Park more. I was not a fan on the level of Brady as far as Jurassic Park goes. I was a little bit older when it came out, but I love the movie. I love watching it, but it wasn't an obsession for me. And then watching this movie has really opened it up on a whole new level to me. But as far as people watching it and getting sick of it, I mean, there is, you spend a lot of time with these movies when you're doing it on a day to day pod. You know, I think Jurassic Park Minute is going to end in 2 weeks from the time we're recording this at minute number 120. So that means we've spent 120 days worth of working on this stuff, or, you know, episodes coming out. So you spend a lot of time with the material, and there's definitely a lot of exposure there and a lot of ways you could get sick of it, just because, you know, if I ate, you know, a Hershey bar with almonds every day for 120 days, I'm pretty sure on day 120, I'd be like, I never want to eat this again, you know, even though I love it. But, you know, with Jurassic Park, it's really been like, I think that when we're done with this, I could turn around and watch Jurassic Park again, and it would be a different viewing experience, because I wouldn't be able to stop telling everybody in the room little facts about everything. It's like, oh, you know, that guy over there, he's actually the gaffer also, you know, something like that. But, It's definitely I feel that I appreciate the movie now more than I did going into this project.
Yeah, definitely. I've actually watched it a few times since we started, and I could easily go turn it on and watch it tonight and not have gotten sick of it at all. I think that's the power of Jurassic Park, the movie. I really do. And I think it's because it's not just a film, man. This is an experience. This is an experience, and it's a moment in time. It's a moment in pop culture history and film history in so many ways. And it's a way of life for a lot of people. I mean, we're sitting here talking about the podcasts that we do about this movie, you know, so it has, I don't know, hit a chord in all of us. And we don't go sit down and watch this movie just to be thrilled by a movie. You know, we go down to enter a whole different place, to get on a different level and just, you know, have the Jurassic Park experience. It's more than just a movie for I think I'm speaking for a lot of people.
Yeah, there's a few franchises out there, you know, Star Wars, you know, Indiana Jones, maybe Pirates, stuff like that, that you want to dive in because you love those worlds and you love what they've built, and you kind of want to be a part of it in a way, you know? And that's what this film does for a lot of people. You want to go and visit that park or Jurassic World and just see these things up close, feel a dinosaur, you know, see one running in front of you, do anything. And because they are so majestic and everything, it's primed for world building and all that stuff. So I'm really glad that they're continuing this trend and just making it bigger and bigger. It's really awesome.
Yeah, me too.
Every now and then you get to a point in your life and you're like, that it's kind of sucks that the life and reality I live, that this isn't a real part of it that I can experience, you know. I wish Tron was a documentary. It's not, so, you know, but it's kind of like this, just taking something like Jurassic Park and jumping into it in a way like this is a way to make it even more real or more a part of your life, you know?
That plays into, you know, back in, what, 2009 when Avatar came out, you know, there were people like going through depression after that movie because the world building in that movie was so epic, and, you know, people wanted to be their own like avatars and do that crazy stuff. And you know, obviously the movie has kind of like, I don't know if it's aged fine, I think, but people just don't really appreciate it as much anymore. But there is that land in Disney World opening up, so it's giving people, you know, a place to go and to be a part of it. So that aspect is really cool.
Now, if that's not a power, speaking to the power of this medium of film, I don't know what is. You know, it's sometimes I want to like walk into Cheers, the bar, and go hang out with my friends, you know, everybody knows my name. and that's, man, it's interesting. And it's cool that Jurassic Park is a movie that's able to make us want to do that. You know, we could want to go to Pandora and things like that, but Jurassic Park is something that could potentially, it feels like it could potentially exist. And that's speaking to the power and the creativity of Michael Crichton. But if you look at a movie like Batman Begins, the idea was that they were taking this kind of extreme thing and setting it in our real world and making it seem plausible as though it could exist. Jurassic Park does that perfectly as well. And it really feels like a tangible, actual idea and a place that you can go. And I think that's another reason we all come back to this, is because it is accessible in a way. It is something that seems real and plausible and a place we could go. And that's you know, that's just more of the draw. That's just more of the draw. You can watch a movie like Star Wars, and Star Wars is kind of a bad example. In fact, it's strange that you were mentioning Avatar, because that's what I would use as something that is a place that just seems so impossible that I almost don't even, you know, put myself in a place where I think I could go there. But Jurassic Park seems like a place that I could go. It seems like Isla Nublar is an actual island 120 miles west of Costa Rica, and that there's a park there that I could go to, you know? So I've made this comment on the show several times. I'm really glad that the film didn't go overly CGI with its kind of tech and its hardware, because that would have distanced us from the movie even more. And one of the things that makes Jurassic Park work so well is the fact that it feels like you could go there. And you don't get, you know, some of the kind of over the top, I don't even know what you would call it, but some of the over the topness, kind of over science fiction looking things you saw in Jurassic World aren't there in Jurassic Park. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, man. It gives it that accessible quality.
It's just because you can do it doesn't mean you should, you know. It's essentially the meaning of Jurassic Park, you know.
That's true. Yeah.
Didn't mean to pull off that pun there, but that's that's essentially what CGI is to a lot of people, you know. I personally loved how they portrayed everything in Jurassic World, but you know, I could see it from the point of view where it's too much, you know, or it's too bombastic, and it is at times, you know, it's crazy. Like it's a completely different movie than Jurassic Park. So,
As filmmakers in the current kind of like filmmaking world, they do have to think about things on like a global level too. This movie isn't just going to play in the United States, because people aren't going to see movies the way they did when Jurassic Park came out. So a movie like Jurassic World, they have to think like, well, what's the one thing that culture and cross language, well, that's visual appeal. So even more CGI. I mean, like, it's funny because I'm pretty sure before Jurassic World started production, half that movie was already done on a computer drive somewhere, you know, and it's just being rendered over and over until the movie comes out. They have to go in deep on the CG because they want this thing to play in Beijing. You know, they want this thing to play cross culture and make a lot of money doing that. So it's almost like a really kind of situation that we've created for ourselves, where the global box office means so much. Well, you know, the only way to really appeal to all markets is to make something, you know, like a visual standout. That's why the Transformer movies do so well, because you don't really need to know a whole lot of plot. You just go in and put on your 3D glasses and you're like, oh, okay, there's Mark Wahlberg and Bumblebee, you know. But there is a point where I think it can be pulled back a little bit more. More time can be spent on character development, and you can get the satisfaction of both a story that resonates within your heart and then also something that's a visual feast for your eyes.
Yeah, it would have been interesting if they had done it differently back then, gone the Jurassic World style and just went all out. Like, you know, more than 15 minutes worth of dinosaurs, you know. Yeah, let's say like 70% dinosaurs and more CGI. Like, it would have been interesting, but I wonder how we would have reacted as a society, you know, because we weren't even used to it back then. You know, that was basically new to us. So would we have that same mentality that we have now? You know, where we're used to it now. Like, we see it, we get it, you know, we understand what's CG and what's not. So it makes me think, like, would we have had that same appreciation, or would we have thought the same way we do think about it now? I don't know.
That's a good question. I think we probably would have rejected a lot more than we actually did, but it's the brilliance of the combination of CG that was still some of the best looking CG I've ever seen in my life, with the Stan Winston Studios, their effort put in as well, which is, you know, whenever we talk about Jurassic Park on our show, and I'm sure you do here as well, it's like we spend most of the time talking about the computer generated images because it was the first time we had seen anything like that. But the Stan Winston Studio brought their A game to that movie, and it really put a lot of money and time and thought into the way that they designed the costumes and the animatronic dinosaurs on it. And it really, it's those two things in combination with each other that really make the visual appeal pop in that movie, you know. But I think if they had just, like you were saying, solely relied on the CG dinosaurs, I think we would have just rejected it wholesale. We would have been like, oh, this stuff has no weight to it in the physical world. The actors aren't looking at things. Their eye lines aren't right. And while we probably wouldn't have been able to notice those on the surface, there's something in our subconscious that would have rejected it, you know?
It would it have turned into, what was it, Tammy the T-Rex or something like that? Would it have been like just too much?
maybe so. Tammy, was it? Was that Theodore Rex with Whoopi Goldberg, or am I thinking of a different movie?
No, you know, I think Tammy the T-Rex is this, like, if I'm remembering correctly, let me look it up here. I think it was a Paul Walker one, right?
Yeah, with, oh my God.
I just found out about this a couple days ago. Yes, that movie looks amazing. So the story is he dies and they put his brain inside of an animatronic Tyrannosaurus Rex, right?
Yeah.
Oh, why aren't we? Well, this is the movie we need to be covering in the Movies by Minute podcast.
I think you're right.
Good Lord.
Oh man.
Yeah. Brian, let me.
Go ahead.
No, you first.
Well, I was going to stick on the topic that you brought up, the animatronics and everything, blending those. But did you guys see that new image that was released as of this recording today by JA Bayona showing the 11 puppeteers? There's like 11 puppeteers like under a flooring, and they're all operating an animatronic above them.
I am going to look for that online right now.
it's coming back, I think. You know, obviously they had it in Jurassic World. There was the Apatosaurus dying there, but the scale wasn't giant. It was long, but it wasn't like huge like the T-Rex or anything like that. Or it wasn't as intense looking as the Velociraptors or the Dilophosaurus or anything. So I wonder like what is above them right now, you know, because that is super interesting picture. You know, what is to come? I have no idea.
Let's see. I'm sorry if it's getting in the way of the show that we're stopping to take a look at this real quick.
No, I was hoping. I didn't know if you guys saw it or not because it was released earlier today, I think. And
yeah,
that's an exciting image, like just to see. Like it's not showing anything except for a group of people under, just like in the operating area where
I tell you what,
maneuvering puppets.
You know what that picture reminds me of? A behind-the-scenes picture you would have seen from Jurassic Park, the original.
For sure.
Absolutely. That's what that brings to mind. Absolutely. And I don't quite know why, but it does. That's exciting.
It looks like those old images of like you'd see the guys at the Stan Winston studio and they're like making a dinosaur out of like egg crates in like a garbage bag, you know, just as a proof of concept. But you look at it and you're like, oh, there's the germination of something amazing going on here, you know?
Oh, yeah.
But, yeah, absolutely.
It's really cool to see that they might be changing it up and might be putting a little bit more, you know, effort or money into this. I don't know. And, you know, going back to the animatronics a little bit more. That's really interesting. So.
Yeah, definitely. Absolutely. Which I'm excited about. And I'm not one of those people who's just always, oh, just animatronics, no CGI, because CGI is just, degraded over time. But it is exciting to see that we're going to be getting something that made such a difference in the first film. The mesh of Stan Winston's work with Dennis Muren's work is just, unparalleled. There is a moment where the T-Rex kind of bumps his head against Malcolm and Grant's tour vehicle. He sees the flashlight, lifts his head up, and almost immediately it's a CG T-Rex kind of walking towards the car. And it's seamless. Uh-huh. It's completely seamless. And I've never seen it handled that well ever since then. And that was kind of at the dawn of when people were implementing that type of effect. And that was, in my opinion anyway, as best it had ever been done, and it's never really gotten that good again, been done that well again.
Yeah, it's tough because you can say, I realize that's CG. It's obvious. It looks CG. But you could say the same thing about animatronics. That's an animatronic. I know.
Absolutely.
I understand. Right. It's an animatronic. It has to be that perfect blend that they did. And they actually did it pretty well in the other ones as well. Even Jurassic Park 3 has like some really awesome blends.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's crazy how they do that stuff.
Yeah. Jurassic Park 3 is, they did a very good job of that. You're right.
When you're diving into this minute by minute, is there anything that has, I guess, surprised you about this first movie? Something I guess maybe you didn't learn or didn't know about before?
If I could, I think the characterization that was going on in this movie is something that was just in the back of my head while I was watching it. Like, I've always liked this movie. I've always liked it a lot, but I never really understood that it was the story of how it was the softening of Dr. Alan Grant. Mm-hmm. You know, that he comes in as this like hard guy that doesn't like kids. And of course, while I was watching it, I was probably picking up in the background, and that's why it was satisfying to me whenever he at the end of the movie is really a caretaker for Tim and Lex. But how this movie made him a father figure for them, it kind of forced into this situation. I think our buddy Scott Carelli from Back to the Future Minute actually made the point when we had him on our podcast for a couple of episodes that the moment that Dr. Grant becomes a father and kind of like lets Lex and Tim snuggle up to him overnight, the next morning is when he finds the eggs and he realizes life has found a way. So in this movie, the point there is that Dr. Alan Grant has become a that is his character's journey is for him to become a more softer, caring human being. That was the kind of stuff that I didn't really notice while we were watching. And Brady, what about you?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think the thing that I've picked up on most is that this is the story of Alan Grant. And that is his journey. Yeah, absolutely. So many of the characters have an arc in this. John Hammond has a wonderful arc. But I think more or less what I have found out is that this is a story about the character of Alan Grant. And that is incredibly interesting. And that, yes, it's about dinosaurs. And yes, it's about the evolution, even if just a temporary one in the short time that they've been back on the planet. We're getting more or less a story of a man, a human being's evolution over a short span of time. And that is just sort of, you know, I guess is the backdrop is the rest of the movie. And I've never seen it like that before. So whenever you are breaking things down minute by minute, you are seeing just in a whole different light. I don't know that I'm ever going to see the movie that the Jurassic Park that I knew before starting this show, Jurassic Park Minute, ever again. I don't know that I'll ever see that movie again. And there's a part of me it's kind of bittersweet because I do like having seen just an overall picture and seeing this movie and being swept up in one feeling. But now that I'm seeing it detail for detail, I'm seeing an entirely different movie. Mm-hmm. And I knew that when I started, the night before we started, I sat down and I watched Jurassic Park and I said, this is going to be the last time that I ever see this movie. And it was a strange sentiment. But the movie that I am seeing now, I think is a better movie almost, because you are seeing everything. You are seeing every characterization. You're seeing every character's arc. You're seeing all these things individually. And it's, yeah, I think the movie benefits from having done this show.
Yeah, I know you guys like to take it easy sometimes on people and you don't always reveal all the like the worst things that you could see in the movies. So that's you know, something you can appreciate there, because sometimes it could ruin your outlook on the movie, and you might see something in the corner or see, you know, this thing here and be like, "Oh, that takes me out of it." You know, "Oh, that's tough." But you guys do a good job of balancing that. And you know, this topic is so dense. Nope. You know, the three of us can attest that there is so much going on, so much research, preparation, and time to produce. And you know, you're talking about dinosaurs, the filmmaking practices, the score even, and the acting, everything. So I got to give you guys, like, you know, kudos for diving into it every day, because I don't know if I could do that, honestly. Like, you know, doing one podcast a week is tough enough when you got to research. So doing it every day, I actually can't even fathom how you guys do that, let alone multiple podcasts. And I know you guys are guesting all the time on different ones. And so that's tough. I give you guys a lot of credit.
Well, thank you.
But it definitely leads to some burnout, too, if we're going to be completely honest. There's a life balance that goes on to doing a day-by-day podcast that, you know, we're not really sure what we're going to do next. And that's kind of how we make it work, too, is just kind of we take it day by day, you know. But it's definitely we love podcasting. It's so much fun. But at some point, real life does kind of like come back into it, as I'm sure you can attest to with, you know, your ailment recently, you know, that it definitely at some point you have to take care of yourself. So the only thing is that you want to make sure that your audience understands that, you know, you don't want to neglect them, but there are other things that are going on too, you know?
Yeah. And you talk about, you know, making a point to not point out the film's flaws, or to go out of your way to do that. You know, we're here to celebrate this movie, and we're here to, you know, talk about why we're doing a podcast about it every day. And if you're just going to be sitting there bashing it, then what's the point? You know?
Yeah, we wouldn't do it in that case.
And that's what I do admire about the Movies by Minutes family. The whole community is that people treat these things with respect, and it's the whole reason they do it. And Yeah. So, I mean, that was just kind of an understood thing. It's nothing we've ever really discussed. You know, let's not point this out. Let's not point that flaw out. It's just, you know, we love the movie. We love the movie. We want to talk about the things we love about it.
Yeah, and I think this community is welcoming and really, really good. You know, like, I was accepted right away, and people want to be a part of what you're doing. And I know you guys probably have a lot of listeners from the community, and you've had a ton of people, like you talked about before. Jennifer, I think, you know, J Jurassic is coming up, I believe, as of this recording. I don't remember. But, yeah, there's all kinds of great people out there that are willing to participate and share and help you, even if you don't know every aspect of it. Like, I don't proclaim to be, you know, an expert on everything or anything like that. So I like it when there's other people out there that can kind of fill in the gaps and, you know, help me understand certain things or these things. Like, one of the funny things that I've talked about before on this podcast is, like, misunderstanding the movie in a way. Like, something that you thought was one way the whole time actually wasn't like that at all. Like, it's really funny. I had that experience with the Richard Kyle, the Richard Kiley voice, you know, the voiceover part where he's, you know, the voice you're hearing is Richard Kiley, spared no expense. So I'm imagining John Hammond with a voice changer as Richard Kiley.
He's
the one sitting in the booth doing it the entire show, which that was my, I don't know why, that was my thought process.
And then
it kind of, you know, it kind of whittled away after I talked with people on the podcast, and I'm like, okay, wait, actually, that's not what happened at all. He just was announcing it like, this voice you're going to be hearing is Richard Kiley. So it's funny how you come across these things when you're diving deep, you know, that surprise you and make you think twice about what you already knew.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's examples that I've been sitting around with my friends before and been, you know, just made an observation or something. They all look at me like, wait, what? How long have you been thinking this, Brady? But that's a whole other thing. Just being able to talk movies, especially a movie that you love with like-minded people like, you know, Jurassic Park. Somebody's able to point something out to you and it changes so much. It just shifts so much. And it's great, man. It's just being a movie geek and is just one of the most rewarding things in life is to be able to just
absolutely
have this conversation right here, you know.
But this is the thing that people have a hard time understanding. What we're doing right now is we've talked for 40 something minutes now about Jurassic Park, a movie that's been out for, you know, whatever, 24 years now. How is that possible? And I know, like, I always have a tough time broaching that topic with people outside of the community and stuff like that, saying, you know, I talk about this on a weekly basis. Do you guys ever have that issue where you're like, yeah, we do it every day?
Yeah, there are some people that are kind of like, how can you mine this material? Like, how much is there to really get out of it? And it's like, well, it's probably between 15 and 30 minutes a day, you know, depending on how our podcast goes. But yeah, there are a lot of people. I mean, you know, and that's kind of the thing of being a fanatic about stuff is having to explain to other people like why you like something so much. Yeah. And, you know, like, for example, my wife and I are huge fans of theme parks and Disney parks specifically. And for a while there, we were going 2 to 3 times a year on different vacations. And awesome. I would have people ask me, like, why are you doing this? Like, you could go anywhere else in the world. And it's like, I can't explain to you why I love the things that I love, but I just love them and I want to be involved with them. You know, so like you're saying, like, you talk about Jurassic Park on this podcast and you talk about it with other people trying to get them into it. It's like, you know, it's just you like the things you like. You know, they're all parts of the things that make you up, you know, and being, and I hate to use this term really, but, you know, being a geek about something is that we're pop culture enthusiasts. We, you know, we eat up everything we can get our hands on, you know, as far as this stuff goes, as far as Jurassic Park goes. It's just a part of your personality and it's something that makes you happy. And what is the point of life other than to surround yourself with the things that make you happy? You
know? Man, we're going deep.
Well, I mean, you know,
We
have spent the last better part of a year, Brady, going deep onto Jurassic Park. So I think, you know, it's a philosophy that we all have, you know.
It's been the better part of 24 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good point.
You know, I was at you're talking about how just a passion for something can bleed over into like every conversation. I went to the Carnegie Museum in Pittsburgh a couple of months ago where they had just a fabulous dinosaur exhibit. And I'm in there with some people, and everything went back to Jurassic Park. And they were just like, oh, God, here we go.
Here we go. Yep.
And a friend of mine was talking to me. This was a couple weeks ago. And he said, hey, so when's your podcast about Jurassic Park start? And I was like, you know what? Some friend you are. You know, it's been going on since October. But you know, he hadn't even mentioned it, but like half a second before the rest of the car ride was Jurassic Park this, Jurassic Park that. And I could just see him kind of smirking, like, you know, I'll just let him do his thing and talk about this freaking movie. But yeah, you know, it's I don't know. Like Kyle was saying, this is just something that enlightens us, and that's it. You don't really need a whole lot more explanation than that, you know, that's the topic of conversation.
Yep. You know, not everybody's going to get it. And you just can't let people tell you what to like or what, you know, how to appreciate a certain topic or a certain thing. You know, some people are all about their jobs or their, you know, everything else. But sometimes when it comes to a fandom, like, that is all you think about sometimes. And I'm the same way with Disney. Like I, like you said, Kyle, I am just like, my brain is 100% in Disney all the time. Like, that's just how I work. And people don't get
that. You're from New Jersey, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, I know that there's a huge subculture of Disney fanatics from New Jersey for some reason. It's like one of the hot spots in the country, so that tracks definitely. But yeah, it's one of those things, like, it's there's so much material to jump into and, you know, read over and study, especially in the world of podcasts. There's like a thousand Disney podcasts out there. It's just one of those things that makes you happy, and, you know, just surround yourself with it. Yeah, surround yourself with it all the time.
Yeah. You know, there's a picture, it's a meme online of a girl, and she's sitting next to an advertisement, which has another group of girls, and they're all eating like yogurt or something, and they're laughing. And this girl who's sitting by the sign is eating yogurt, and she's laughing at them. And the text, it says, this is what listening to podcasts is like. And it's kind of relevant to what we're talking about, in the sense that, you know, You've got like-minded people out there who are geeking out and obsessing over these certain topics, and you feel like you know them. You feel like you're friends with them. It's like you talk to them every day, and you tune into these podcasts because it's something that enlightens you. And that picture is very, very true. There's a lot of truth in that picture. But
And you know, it's funny because this lifestyle creates friends and friendships and stuff that will probably last a very long time, and if not more than real life friends, like, you know, real life as in people you see every day, you know. But I've made some really great friends and people that I could call best friends over just podcasting or just being on Twitter or, you know, anywhere really. And it's funny how that works and how you find those like-minded people and it works out like that. It's really great.
And you've actually had the privilege of meeting some of these people in person at the Jurassic World exhibit at the Franklin Institute. Yeah. I think you organized like a big meetup.
Yeah.
And, you know, Jennifer, like we talked about, was there. I think some other podcasters about Jurassic Park were there as well. I would have loved to have made that.
But, dude, it's another experience, like getting to, you know, because you get to know people online. And like you said, you feel like you know people that you listen to their podcasts and stuff like that. So when you go up to them and you're like, hey, man, and they have no clue who you are. But in this case, like, we interacted and everything. So there was no awkward moment. It's just like you just go in and it's just like we're best friends already. You know, like it works out that way. So it's really cool how that works. And I had the same situation with Jennifer and Josh down in Disney World. We all just so happened to be at the parks at the same time.
Wow.
And that was the first time we met up. We met up at Jock Lindsay's Hangar Bar, and that was so cool. So awesome.
That's so cool. Well, soon enough, man, we're all going to have to, I think there should really be a big Jurassic podcast get together.
Yes.
Where we get everybody can get together and hang out and do exactly what we're doing right now.
So. Absolutely. And yeah, like we were talking about, it's no, you know, it's not difficult at all just to get together and talk about this for hours. And I think it's easy. Absolutely. But you know what? I'm going to grill you guys just a little bit, just to find out
if you guys
are real fans or no. I'm kidding. But did you guys get into the toys and stuff when you were younger? Were you into that stuff? Because I feel like we're probably around the same age. So did you guys own any of those?
Yeah, it's, you know, the ability to. Okay, so this movie obviously spoke to us, as we have been, you know, reiterating. spoke to us a lot, and we were, it came out around, I think it was 8 years old. So that's, you know, about the time a kid is getting action figures for everything, you know, G.I. Joe, whatever show or movie you're into. And Jurassic Park had a really cool toy line because all of the action figures were as they were in the movie. It wasn't like, you know, submersible Ian Malcolm. And, you know, he didn't come with like all this crazy gear for going underwater or whatever.
Save that for the next movie.
Yeah, exactly. So you could actually sort of like play the movie. And the dinosaurs were authentic to how they looked in the movies. And you had the vehicles and the compound and all that. So yeah, man, I definitely racked up on as much of that as I could. And, yeah, to answer your question.
Now, Kyle, you mentioned you're a little bit older. Was this kind of out of your range? 'Cause I know toys are tough. If you're out of that range, it doesn't actually work out and you never get into them the way some of the younger kids did.
Yeah, okay, I'll answer for Kyle.
If you go ahead,
in his office, yeah. If you go in his office, you're going to see all of the like collectible aliens figures and everything. Okay. So it's a different thing, you know, like a collector's standpoint. So.
Yeah. I think at the time that the movie came out, I wasn't really into toys or action figures as much as I was when I like turned like 22 and I was like, oh wait, I don't care what people think about me. I'm going to spend all my disposable income on candy and action figures. But I always appreciated the Jurassic Park toy line that came out because of course I have three younger brothers, Brady is one of them, and they had all the action figures and the Tyrannosaurus Rex, which I think Jay Jurassic referred to as the Red Rex.
Yes.
I remember picking it up one time and looking at it and being like, oh my God, somebody spent a lot of time working on this. This might be one of the greatest action figures I've ever seen. Had that tail that could roll around, you squeeze the hips and it made a roar and everything. Mm-hmm. And it was the action figure line for Jurassic, I mean, it was Kenner, right? That did the toys.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I think Kenner also did like the Operation Aliens action figures that came out. And I think the Robin Hood figures. And I think they kind of like reused some of the same molds and crossed over in a lot of those. Huh. But it was very cool to see, that stuff, and just, you know, the way they were again, bringing that world into, you know, of course there's a cynical way to look at it too and be like, well, it's just marketing, you know, they're trying to get money out of kids, but yeah, maybe, but at the same time, they took such care with that stuff and did such a fantastic job with it. It was, that line was actually really cool.
You know, interesting. You mentioned the Red Rex, JC of Jurassic Collectibles was telling me that they actually used the mold for that toy from the actual mold that they used for the like animatronic in the movie, like, you know, a down, you know, one that's brought down to scale.
Mm-hmm.
So what you're saying is like of the same mold for the one in the movie, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like the coloring and everything looks slightly different. Yeah. But yeah, that's awesome. I that is my favorite. Got to be my like one or two number favorite, because the other Rex from the second movie is just as awesome.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. And the action figure for that was the one where I think it would swallow a guy
exactly,
in like a capsule.
Yeah.
And pull that stomach. Yeah, and it was cool because it was, you know, that was the male Rex, the bull Rex, mm-hmm. which was great because they made it stand out, too. So
yes.
Another reason for the kids to go out and buy another one because, well, it's different, you know, and this is the mommy and the daddy, and they go together, you know?
Yeah.
But, yeah, no, those were, I liked all the stuff in that line, but that Rex really stood out to me as something special.
Yeah, it's funny how it comes in circles and waves. You know, you're into these toys when you're younger, and then look, you know, we all got shelves now filled with these things. It's pretty ridiculous.
Oh, yeah.
Just wasting our money. You know, I don't know if you can consider it wasting or not, because it's not like, I mean, speaking for myself, I don't like sit here and play the way I used to. You know, I don't, you know, create scenarios and all that stuff like I did, but they are there and they're on the shelves and they're, you know, they're in cabinets and. And yeah. I don't know what value that brings to my life, but aside from knowing I have it and knowing it's there and seeing it every once in a while, it's pretty special.
I'll tell you what it is, Brett. It's the same thing that we were talking about earlier, in the sense that we get together and talk about Jurassic Park or other subjects, like, because it enlightens you. Mm-hmm. It's like, I am actually an art collector and I have rooms full of art that I'm never going to display, and I have it because it just enlightens me, you know?
Yeah. I got a problem like
it's
that too. I got drawers full of art that are not hung anywhere.
Yeah.
Just in a damn drawer.
Crazy.
You need more walls. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's the same thing as, like, you know, a sports fan collecting, like, a Jets helmet or, like, a Saints jersey or something like that. It's just kind of but, you know, for us, it's toys that young children usually play with, and we're all adult males and we have to, you know, put them up on a shelf somewhere. But you know, just surround yourself with the things you like, you know, and eventually at some point, if you get tired of it and want to move it off somewhere else, you know, that's what the glory of eBay is for. There's somebody else out there that's looking for it, you know.
Funny story. So I found just a horde of original Star Wars action figures that were worth God knows how much money that Kyle had when he was a kid. And I probably found all these things when I was maybe like 12, and I had a big empty armoire in my bedroom. So I was like, I'm making this a shrine to these, like, collect, you know, this, all these collectibles that are just collector's items, and had them all lined up with action figures and vehicle, all kinds of stuff. Well, it just kind of sat in there for years and years and years. I'm dating someone when I'm like 18 years old, and a friend of mine comes in and he's like, "Oh, Brady, I wonder what's in here. Oh, look at that, Star Wars toys." Okay. And I was like, "This."
Yeah, but also at the same time, a lot of my friends in college at the time would ask if I, like, brought them. We're like hanging out, and we swung by the house. They'd be like, "Hey, can I see Brady's, like, Star Wars collection?" And it's funny because a lot of those guys were like film geeks, and a lot of them have gone on into film careers and stuff like that. And they'd always come in and sit there and, like, look at him and talk to Brady about him, and be like, "Okay, so this is the Bubba Fett that actually has the spring-loaded missile in the back. Wow, that's pretty amazing, you know." Yeah, and I'm sitting there in the background going, like, "Well, those used to be mine."
It's funny because when you reach a certain point in your age, you know, you're like kind of shy or afraid of those things, and you put them away, and then later on you see people like pulling out, you know, "Oh, I had all this, I had all these Star Wars toys," or "I had these Jurassic Park toys." And I'm like a friend of mine, I was like, "Man, I had no clue during all our years of high school that you were ever into these things." Like, you know, like, I would have loved to have known that.
Yeah.
It was like an embarrassment, but it's funny because now it's like, you know, the I hate to use the word again, but the geek's taking its revenge, and now everybody's a geek, you know, like, cause there's such a way to, and it's kind of cynical again, but, you know, to market this stuff and get it out to people and produce all this stuff. It's funny because, like, when I was in high school, it was like the last thing you ever wanted to do was admit you had a box of Star Wars action figures in the top of your closet, you know, or that you were going to the comic book store, you know, to buy a new issue of, like, Bloodshot or something like that. Yeah. But now it's like, there's no judgment now, which is great. I really envy a lot of people growing up right now that you can be into all that stuff, and it's really accepted that, you know, you can, you know, it's kind of weird because there isn't the out of the way mom and pop store that you had to find in, you know, the dark corner of the city that sold, you know, like, bootleg anime, you know, and stuff like that. Now it's just like you can order it or find it in Barnes and Noble. It's everywhere. In fact, if anything, there's too much of it at some point, you know.
Yeah.
But it's great that you don't have to be embarrassed of that stuff anymore, you know.
You know, it's funny. I had a job, ridiculous job, a couple of years ago. And of course, I'm sitting there doing what I did every day, and that is surfing the web. And I was looking at, like, a price guide for, I think it was like original Raiders of the Lost Ark action figures. I wanted to see how much one of these things I had was worth, because it's worth so much money. And I'm sitting there looking at it, and this dude walks by and he's like, "What in the hell are you looking at, really?" And I was like, "Yeah, you know what? The Belloc that is actually, you can get outside of his ceremonial robes is worth, you know, whatever it was." And he was like, "Really?" And he sat down, and I was explaining this to him. He was like, "Well, what about, like, the Indiana Jones, like, without the hat or whatever?" And it was just, you know,
to be a collector of anything. Yeah.
yeah, exactly. So
that's happened plenty of times. I'll be at work, you know, browsing Jurassic Park stuff, and half the time people walk by and see dinosaurs on my screen, and I'm wondering, what are they thinking right now as they see me researching this stuff, or on jptoys.com, like, just looking through all the dinosaur toys. I'm always wondering, you know, what's going through their minds as they watch and see me do this. One time, you know, I did hear somebody whistle the Jurassic Park theme, and I was like, "Who did that?
Oh,
like,
cool.
Who was that?"
Yeah. I would just turn and say, "Yes, I am. By golly." And if you want to hear about it, I've got hours worth of convo for you. Yeah. So careful. But,
Have you guys read the book at all? I know it's a tough subject for some. Some have, some haven't. So where do you guys stand with that?
Yeah, multiple times. I love the book. There are definitely things I don't like about it. I think the character of Lex is kind of a throwaway. She just kind of gets in the way, in my opinion. But, yeah, I love the book.
Yeah, I read it in 1993, and that kind of led me to have an obsession with Michael Crichton. And I read everything that he had published up until that point in the first semester of my ninth grade high school year. Mm-hmm. And then I pretty much stopped reading after that point, which was a horrible embarrassment because I think I started down this path of like, oh, books are great. I'm going to read anything. And then immediately when I was like, I finished like Eaters of the Dead or something like that, I was like, well, that was a fun thing to do. I'll never read another book again. But the book Jurassic Park is – it's so hard to say because the movie is so great and the book is so great, but it's almost hard to quantify them against each other because it's apples and oranges because there's so much different that happens in between the two. But yeah, Michael Crichton, I love his work, and I'm so glad to hear that he actually has a new book coming out in just a couple of months. And strange enough, it's also about dinosaurs. We lost the gentleman a few years ago, which is unfortunate, but I'm glad that they've been able to kind of like collect his notes and release that Pirate Latitudes, his last couple of books. That he was working on.
So one of the things I find very difficult is trying to intertwine the discussion, because when you're doing a Movies by Minute podcast, how do you broach that topic because the book is so different than the movie? It's got to be tough, because I try to stay mostly away from the book when possible because it is so different. So how do you guys do that when you're discussing the topics?
We address it, I think, as long as it's not going to get in the way of the movie. We'll say like, it was interesting when this happened in the book, and not to make a comparison or say one is better than the other, but
we do also try to pick apart parts of the book that weren't included in the movie that have been incorporated in the later movies. Like, in Jurassic Park 3, they did kind of try to bring in that river rafting thing to a degree. They had some scenes that are kind of in there. But we don't want to – I mean, it would be very easy to say, like, the book is so much better because it's just the scope of it is – it would have been unfilmable at the time. But I don't know that it's necessarily say that it's really better because the movie works so damn well on its own,
Yeah.
But it is something that comes up. But most of the time, we just try to talk about the differences between the two and be like, oh, that would have been really cool. We didn't get that. Okay, let's just move on to the next thing. But it's definitely come up a few times in the course of the podcast.
Yeah, absolutely. You know what I think would be really cool is the Movies by Minute format somehow taken and applied to literature.
Oh, God. Is it going to be a page by page podcast?
I don't know,
you can do audiobook by minute.
Audiobook by minute. Yeah. Yeah. Something like that would probably never work, but
audiobooks tend to be like 15 hours. You're talking about like a lot of minutes. That's a lot of your life.
A whole lot.
So, we've talked about how polarizing the final two films are so far. I got to ask, how do you rank these movies?
Oh man. Brady, why don't you go first?
There's no way to answer this question without, somebody probably shaking their fist at their radio as they're listening to it. Personally, I would probably say Jurassic Park, obviously, number one. Jurassic Park 3 as my number two. And probably The Lost World and then Jurassic World. Okay. Jurassic World, there was some things in it that just fell really flat for me. And I went into it knowing that you're not going to get Jurassic Park. Uh-huh. This is a new movie. It's a new generation. It's a new movie. Movies are not made the same way anymore. So get used to that. And I said, okay, no problem. I can see it like as its own thing, and went in there and still got something that I feel was just kind of, 14 years worth of screenplay drafts kind of stapled together. Mm-hmm. And it just didn't really work for me. The Lost World, I think, is the older, the more I watch The Lost World, the more I'm okay with it. I think it's doing some things like really, really, really well. But for the most part, the movie just kind of feels a little like tedious and a little, it drags a lot for me. Jurassic Park 3 is definitely just a big, dumb, fun movie. And it's also something that was just sort of like pieced together because the production was so hectic. But it's also, it's got some really fun set pieces in it, some really great moments. It's really cool to see Alan Grant come back. And so for that reason, I kind of let it, take the number two spot. But it's just a series that has not really been what I think it could have been post the first film. And it's a real shame, I think, that we didn't get just stellar movies to come after that. Mm-hmm. So I guess to answer your question the longest way I can, you know, that's the order that I put them in.
I like that. That's interesting. I don't think I've gotten that kind of order before. That's good. I like that appreciation for Jurassic Park 3.
Sure. Kyle, what about
I'm
you?
Probably going to have to answer in the same way, although I want to make a small caveat and say that the Telltale Games Jurassic Park pieced together on YouTube as a movie might be my number two, because I actually think that story does some really cool things. But yeah, I'm going to say the same thing. I think Jurassic Park 3 is a chase movie at its heart, and it doesn't really try to be anything else. I think The Lost World has a lot of moments in it that are really that are great. That Tyrannosaurus Rex attack, where the mobile lab goes off the side of the cliff, is pretty awesome. But I feel that the movie kind of doesn't really end well. That the last third of the movie is kind of like it's just a bunch of stuff that happens. But you know, for me, Jurassic World is I gotta kind of reiterate some of what Brady says, and I want to make a statement here that I don't think that movie's faults are the fault of the director in charge of the project at all. I feel like the script was put together of decades plus worth of different ideas for what would have been Jurassic Park 4, and I think that Colin Trevorrow is a guy who, with an indie film background, did a masterful job of navigating the studio system and having to serve the different masters of Spielberg and Amblin and Universal and try to make everybody happy. And at the end of the day, that movie made over $1 billion, so everybody was very happy with that. I think that in a creative environment where he is working with Kathleen Kennedy and the guys over the Star Wars department at Disney, I think we're going to see a much different film come out of that, that he's given a little bit more creative control over it. But Jurassic World for me was the thing that just didn't work for me was that it felt like four different movies chopped up and put in a blender. You know, there's a movie in there about using dinosaurs as weapons. There's a brotherly love movie about probably like a kid with autism and his older brother having to kind of deal with him as their parents are getting a divorce, and there's also kind of this like action chase movie in the middle of it that tries to retread a lot of what happened in Jurassic Park. And those movies were just trying to serve too many different masters to me, and at the end of the day I walked out of the theater just kind of like really just kind of with a bad taste in my mouth as far as that one went. I'm looking forward to Jurassic World 2, Jurassic Age, whatever it's going to be called, because I think the creative team in charge of that is going to correct anything that went bad on the last movie, and also they've been saying the right thing so far. The tone pieces that we've seen in the little videos they've been released really are hitting the right notes for me. So but yeah, I Jurassic Park obviously number one. You know, it's there was a reason it was the for a very, very long time.
Yeah. Now, speaking of Jurassic Park, the original, it's the 25th anniversary coming up next year. So
yeah,
is there anything that you guys would love to see, because you've dissected this so much, is there anything that you'd like to see stand out during the 25th anniversary? Anything that you'd like to, you know, like whether it's more special features, deleted scenes, toys, anything?
I'm always down for more special features. As someone who's just a huge fan of special edition DVDs and whatnot, you know, the more material, the better. I would love to see contemporary interviews with the cast and the crew and where they've come. I know that it hadn't been that long since we got our Blu-ray release, but I don't care. At the same time, I want to see Sam Neill tell more stories about
Keep
it.
Keep spending.
Yeah, there's a lot of deleted scenes, like deleted material from the film out there that has just kind of never been seen. I would love to see some of that. You know, I really, it's any other time, if you were to ask me that question, I'd have like a more complete answer for you, but not right now.
Yeah, I know. I probably say the same thing. I think that, you know, the cast and crew, everybody is still in relatively good health. So now is the better time than any to get them all together and to produce a long feature length documentary on the making of this film, how the franchise has affected people, how it affected filmmaking. Because I know that going into that movie, they knew they had something special, but at the time, the stories I've heard coming from the set were that Steven Spielberg had just come off of Hook. There's this story about him at the premiere of Hook where he goes out to his limo and he actually cries and doesn't finish watching the movie because he knows that he had made something that wasn't going to stand the test of time. Then the next two films he makes within the same year are Jurassic Park and Schindler's List. Yeah. You know, and I know that a lot of the production of or the editing of Jurassic Park, he was watching them do while he was actually directing Schindler's List, and he kind of felt removed from it because of the gravity of that project. So I really want to get into his mind as a creative person working with Michael Crichton, the estate of Michael Crichton, you know, like pulling any documents that they can out of his kind of like philosophy of going into the movie, how he was obsessed with chaos theory at the time, and this is the movie that we got out of that subject, is very interesting to me. So yeah, I'm the same way. I would, even if it's like a feature release that could be in theaters, I would love to really see them put a lot of time and effort into a documentary that really kind of like covered this movie for more than 2 hours.
Absolutely.
Have you guys seen it in theaters before?
Yeah, I mean, there was whenever it premiered. I'll never forget that experience. Oh man, that was a humbling experience. And then when it was released on in 3D a few years ago, that was also an amazing experience. I'm not a huge fan of seeing movies in 3D on the big screen, but man, they got it right with that.
Oh, it worked. Yeah,
it held up.
It absolutely held up. Yeah, but I can remember, just go down memory lane real quick. Speaking of opening night, whenever this film was coming out, the hype, just getting ready, being so excited and going into it thinking like, you know, dinosaurs, how scary can they be? It's Denver, the Last Dinosaur. It's Barney or whatever. And I mean, the second that first note of music and that opening title sequence comes on, you're like, oh no. Oh boy.
It's different.
And you're a man now, Brady.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, when the T-Rex comes out and just kind of, you know, lets out his mighty roar and everything. Just this was not the experience that I thought I was going to get. And it was, I had never had an experience in the movie theater like that before. So it was incredible. And to have had that experience as your first experience like that, with it being Jurassic Park, was just something else, man. That's, you know, a memory I definitely cherish.
Awesome. Well, you know, we're winding down here towards the end. I know you guys mentioned the Patreon a little bit before, but why don't you kind of just let everybody know as to what is involved with this Patreon account and, you know, what you have to offer, you know, to the people who are patrons.
Yeah, absolutely. So we have a kind of a company that we are producing this podcast under, which is kind of like the thing you do if you know want to be writing it off on your taxes or whatever. So what we decided to do in order to because I'm sure as you could attest to, Brad, that podcasting is a thing that's a lot of fun but it takes up a lot of time. And if you can get something to kind of offset the cost that you put into it, that works out great. So what we wanted to do was to offer a little bit more for the people out there that wanted to help us out. So what we do is every week we put out at least we try to make it about an hour episode of a bonus podcast through Pele Media. Our Patreon account is patreon.com/PeleMedia if your listeners are interested in checking that out. And what we do is whatever we're talking about at the time, we try to kind of grab something that is related to it and talk about that for, you know, about an hour a week. So as the time of this recording, tomorrow we will be releasing an episode which is just Brady and I talking about the movie Sphere and the book Sphere. Mm-hmm. We kind of tied it back into Michael Crichton with that. When we were doing Ghostbusters, we had all sorts of crazy episodes where I think one day Brady and I went out to like Walmart and we found that they had Ecto Cooler and the special edition Twinkies that came along with Ghostbusters, and we had just kind of an episode where we sat down and we reviewed the junk food. So nice. All sorts of stuff like that. Well, we talk about films that are out in the theater right now at the end of the year. We did like our top 10 films of the year and stuff like that. But it's basically a little bit something to say thank you for supporting us every week. And our price for that is $1 a month. So at $1, the cost of $1 a month, you get like 4 bonus episodes for that. So we're going to, I think, we've got one coming out tomorrow, which is going to be Sphere. We have something we haven't announced after that, and I'll go ahead and announce it right now. We're going to be reviewing Lost World as probably one of our last episodes of the Jurassic Park edition.
Jurassic.
Thank
World.
You. That's a problem that I've had throughout the podcast. I mess up the two of those. So
same
Jurassic
here.
World is what we'll be talking about. And we're going to have our good buddy Scott Corelli from Back to the Future Minute is going to be on because he specifically requested to be on for that episode because he has a lot of thoughts about it. So.
Nice. Yeah.
You can, with the premium content that we have on there, it is a little bit cooler than listening to us eat Twinkies. We've had a lot of stuff that I'm particularly proud of. And one of them was actually a pretty long Patreon episode that we did where we talked about the planned but never executed animated series, Jurassic Park animated series that was going to come out right after the first film, which is just a fascinating, just entire thing. It's such a fascinating story behind the conception of that idea and why it never happened. You know, I'm particularly proud of a lot of the ones that we did for Ghostbusters Minute, but for the most part, all of our Patreon episodes have covered Jurassic Park, all kinds of material. In fact, one of the most recent ones we did was a review of the original script for the movie and just how different that was going to be. So...
That's some awesome content. You know, I was scrolling through. I think you guys covered like the Jurassic Park ride, the Lego Indominus movie, and it's great content, great stuff, and it's so cheap. So just go ahead and go support it. You know, get out there, go do it.
Yeah, thank you.
Glad to hear that you like that. Those episodes were a lot of fun to do.
Yeah, so one of the things I wonder about as a podcaster, when you're doing this movies by minute, now that's a lot of minutes, so that's a lot of episodes. Now, I know podcasting, like we're talking about now, is not always cheap or anything like that. So do you guys keep, like with this format, do you guys keep those podcasts available for a while, or what's the deal with that?
That's our plan at the moment, is to, you know, it's really weird because we've looked at the subscription numbers of our previous show, Ghostbusters Minute, which wrapped up around October or November, right before around the same time Jurassic Park Minute debuted. Mm-hmm. And we've actually seen that those subscription numbers have climbed. So with a movies by minute format, or like a serialized type episodic thing like we're doing here, we've noticed that the longer you keep it out there, the more people come to it. So I'm sure a lot of your listeners right now might be interested in what we're doing. And even though we're about to wrap up the show, they can go back and start with minute number one and listen to it at their own pace throughout the entire course of the show. So our plan is to keep that up there until we see the numbers stagnate. And once we start to see it stagnate, then we're going to try to move it over to something else. Now, if that be at YouTube or Libsyn or something, we haven't really come to that yet. But right now, what it costs us and what is offset by our Patreon supporters who are out there, you know, helping us out, that's just kind of like what we're going to do to keep it going in the meantime. And if everybody decides to unsubscribe from Patreon tomorrow and we're just left eating the cost for ourselves, we're probably going to keep it up for a couple of years. And then we'll see, you know, at what point podcasting even looks like at that point.
True.
You know?
Very true. Yeah, you got to see how it goes and just look at the numbers. But yeah, that's awesome. And they will be available for everybody to listen to for a while. So that's always good to know. Definitely go back, everybody listening. Listen to all those episodes. I've done it myself and I'm caught up. I got to listen to today's episode still, but it's awesome. It's a lot of fun, and it's fun to dive in. Even though this is what I do every week, it's fun to listen to you guys talk about it every day. So I love
that. Thank you. Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you for what you do. You have a fantastic podcast.
Well, thank you. You know, I do what I can.
Yeah.
But where can everybody find you guys, you know, throughout the web, or, you know, where to listen to the podcast?
Yeah, we're available on pretty much wherever you can find podcasts, like the fine one you're listening to right now. Just search for Jurassic Park Minute. We have our website, JurassicParkMinute.com. You can also look for Ghostbusters Minute, which was our previous show, and Goonies Minute, which Brady is doing with his co-host Chris, which I think still has a couple more months to go. Like we also said, you can find us on Patreon at patreon.com/PeleMedia. That's P-E-L-E, just like the Hawaiian volcano god. We're also available on Facebook. Search for any those things: Goonies Minute, Ghostbusters Minute, Jurassic Park Minute, Pele Media, and then my personal Twitter handle is at Kyle Crane. So yeah,
awesome. Yeah. Well, thank you guys so much for coming on, and I can't wait for everybody to hear this, and yeah, we'll have to do this again sometime.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Brad. This is something I've been looking forward to for a while. Thanks for having
me
us
too.
On.
Me too. Thank you. Talk to you guys soon.
All right, man. Bye.
In the audio segment, we have a new contributor to the podcast. You may know him as Owen from Jurassic World, Chris Pratt. He's here with a new segment called What's My Snack? And he breaks down each snack that he has here on the set of Jurassic World 2. Let's take a listen.
Hey, Chris Pratt here on the set of Jurassic World 2. Now for a new segment I call What's My Snack? Cacao, baobab, banana, chia, huh? Cacao, baobab, banana, chia. Cacao, baobab, banana, chia. Cacao, baobab, banana, chia. Cacao, baobab, banana, chia.
It's a cacao, baobab, chinina.
Hey gang, Chris Pratt here, back with another segment of What's My Snack? And today we're trying some assorted sashimi. Let's take a look.
Oh, it's so good.
This smells and tastes exactly like Berkeley Power Bait. I get it. I see why trout love it. It's so good. Totally raw fish. This is seaweed. This is one of those things where when you're as hungry as I am, everything tastes really good. But this is especially good. Oh, check that out. Spanish mackerel.
Hey guys, hi guys. Chris Pratt here. Another episode of What's My Snack? And honestly, it's pretty late. And I'm so hungry. It's 10:53 p.m. and I should go to bed. But instead, I'm gonna maybe eat my snack for tomorrow. Ooh, it's an olive oil pistachio cake. But I'm supposed to eat that tomorrow, not today. Oh, when I do it. So what if I only have half? Some for tomorrow. I saved just a little bit for tomorrow.
Hey, yo, what's up? Chris Pratt here. So, I'm a little embarrassed from my last video. It seemed a little weak. And I'm here to tell you that snacks, they don't have that kind of power over me. Okay? Nothing does. Because I'm strong. I'm a man. I'll get all hung up over some cake, over some snack. Okay? So, just to let you know, I ain't like that. So today, I'm gonna do a new episode, a more manly episode of What's My Snack? See, it's an apple. Just an apple. I'm gonna eat it. I ain't gonna try to be all weird about it. Just what I do.
All right, so maybe it's not a new segment for us. He posted these videos over on Instagram. They're so hilarious. I had to include them. They're really awesome. Anyway, if you want to see the videos yourself, head to the links within our show notes. Make sure to visit JurassicParkPodcast.com to find all our past episodes, brand new news articles, information on how to contact us, and much more. It's a great source for everything related to the podcast, and of course, Jurassic Park and Jurassic World. Head to JurassicParkPodcast.com and help us build a great community.
Anybody hear that?
Thanks for listening to the 91st episode of the Jurassic Park Podcast. Of course, a huge thanks to Kyle and Brady from Jurassic Park Minute. You really need to check out their Movies by Minute podcast. It's so awesome. They dive deep into Jurassic Park on a daily basis, so their show certainly deserves a listen. Head to our show notes to find all of their links. Thanks again to everybody who entered, shared, retweeted, reposted, commented, and followed us due to the ticket giveaway. Congrats to all the winners from our website, Instagram, and Twitter. You're all so awesome. Thank you so much, and I really hope you enjoy the exhibition. Don't forget about the promo code that we're running with the Franklin Institute for Jurassic World, the exhibition. Enter the code JWGENER to get $5 off daytime adult admission tickets. Head to our website for a direct link and for more information on the promo code. Don't forget to share the code with your friends and family. Tell them where you got it and let us know when you use it. If you want to interact with us, we do most of our work over on Twitter at Jurassic Park Pod. We're also on Facebook at facebook.com/Jurassic Park Podcast, and our Instagram handle is at Jurassic Park Podcast. You can listen to us via iTunes, Google Play, Podomatic, YouTube, our website, or wherever else podcasts are found. So make sure to subscribe to automatically get new episodes every week. If you haven't already, please give us a 5-star review in iTunes or a great review wherever you listen to the podcast. Don't forget to check out JurassicParkPodcast.com for all the links you heard here today. If you want to get a hold of us, you can email us with any news stories, MP3s, comments, or if you want to debut a segment of your own, send them to JurassicParkPod@gmail.com, or you can submit questions directly on our website contact form. If you'd like to record something for the show, send it in to us and we'll feature it in an upcoming episode. If you don't have any way to record, you can give our voicemail line a call and leave us a message. That number is 732-825-7763. Thanks for listening and enjoy.
Drop what you're doing and leave now.